Will the congregation please rise out of respect for the family of Ron Boyer? You may be seated. Good morning. The psalmist David declared, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." We're gathered here this morning to mourn the death, but more importantly, celebrate the life of Ronald Charles Boyer. On behalf of Kathy and Brad and Darren and their families, I want to thank each of you for coming today. Your presence here is a gift of love and support that gives them the strength and the courage that they need to face what is a new normal and to begin that journey of life without Ron's physical presence in it. Thank you for being here, for your encouragement, your care, and the comfort that you bring. This morning, we are a people who live with hope. Ron Boyer knew Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And that relationship brought to him and brings to each of us today the promise of eternal life and the hope of heaven. The words of Jesus in John's gospel speak to this when Jesus declared, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Because we have that hope, we also have assurance today that God is with us. And Kathy, you know that. His grace is sufficient for us, and under his everlasting arms, we can find peace. This morning, we can join with the psalmist in our time of need and say, "I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. For the Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun will not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. For the Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul. The Lord will guard your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forever." And so hear these words today, these words of promise, these words of assurance. For in Isaiah 41, the Lord says, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will surely uphold you with my righteous right hand." May God add his blessing to the reading of the word. Shall we pray? Father, we bow before you today so incredibly thankful for your presence in this place. Your word declares that where two or three are gathered, there you are in the midst of them. And so today as we come with the assurance that you are here to bring comfort and strength, encouragement and hope to us as we say goodbye to that which is physical of a very special man. God, I pray today for Kathy. I pray for Brad. I pray for Darren, for all of the family, that today your grace would be sufficient for their needs. These are days of adjustment and change. And these are days when they need your hope and your help and your presence more than perhaps any other time in their life. And I just pray, God, you would draw near and that you would provide all that they need. Thank you, Lord, for being with us today. And bless us as well as we remember a friendship and the times that we spent with this special man. Be with us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. There was a special song that kind of describes what Ron brought to the world, and we're going to listen to it now. Ronald Charles Boyer was born in Danbury, Nebraska on October the 5th, 1939, to Charles and Winona Boyer. He died on May the 31st, 2020, at his home here in Salinas, surrounded by his family. Ron was 80 years of age. Ron grew up and attended school in Solomon, Kansas, where he met his bride of 64 years, Rita Kathleen Bradley Boyer. They reunited in marriage in 1956, and the Boyers made their home in Solomon, Kansas, where they raised three sons. And Ron worked first as a Fuller Brush salesman, going door to door, later as a car salesman for Long MacArthur Ford. They then moved to Colorado Springs in 1989, where Ron worked as a realtor at Rawhide Realty. And in 1997, they moved back to Salina to be close to their grandchildren, where Ron finished his career at Millwood Realty, retiring in 2012. Ron and Kathy made their retirement home here in Salina. Ron was an avid sportsman and loved the outdoors. He enjoyed hunting, fishing, camping with family and friends. Surviving today is Ron's wife, Kathleen Boyer, and sons Brad Boyer and wife Darlene of Payton, Colorado, and Darren Boyer and wife Gail of Salina. Seven grandchildren, Lyle Boyer, wife Chrissy, Jamie Snow and wife Jeremy, Josh Boyer and wife Ashley, Brenton Boyer, Adam Boyer, Zane Heigel, and Logan Heigel, and 10 great-grandchildren. He's also survived by one sister, Roberta Johannes, and one brother, Alan Boyer. Ron was preceded in death by his son, Russell, his great-granddaughter, Paige Boyer, his parents, and his siblings, Charlene, Dick, Enid, and Lois. There are many words that could be used to describe Ron this morning. As I sat around their table last night and we talked about it, I got a lot of stories and have had to really work to sort out what I'd share and what I wouldn't, because some I probably shouldn't. Isn't that right, guys? But we're going to do our best to give you a few things. I asked the family last night, give me a list of adjectives that would describe this man. It was kind of fun. They said he was committed to the core in leading and caring for their family. He was a hard worker since he was a child, and he always made certain that the needs of his family were cared for, and he would do anything to help anyone in need, provided that they were honest and had done something to help themselves. Ron lived by the adage that you don't quit until the job is finished, and he passed that trait on to his family. For Ron, life was black and white, right and wrong, good and evil. There was no middle ground. He wouldn't compromise. There were no gray areas, and that was just the way it was. Now, the boys said yesterday that he kind of softened as he got a little older because the grandkids kind of got his heart, but he didn't soften much. There was still a line, and you really didn't want to cross it. His boys used the words stubborn to describe him. And while that word fits, his stubbornness was built around a set of principles that demanded honesty, integrity, and hard work. Ron loved, and he lived for his grandkids. And you guys know that. You know that to Grandpa, you were the apple of his eye. He was always spot on with his teasing, and he could get the best of anyone with a very sharp wit and keen sense of humor. On July the 10th, 1956, Ron and Kathleen were united in marriage in Abilene at the Christian Church. High school sweethearts, they were both 16 years old when they married. By the time they were 18, they had two sons. By the time they were 21, they added one more. Ron was dedicated to caring for his family, and he worked hard to provide for them. He's always been a salesman. He started as a Fuller Brush salesman, going door to door, and he must have done pretty well because he took good care of the family. Kathy said that Ron was kind of mature beyond his years, and he helped her to grow up from being a farm girl to the beautiful lady that she is today. Family meant everything to him. And that is a character trait that he has passed on to his children, his grandchildren, and his friends. There were times he would ask me here at church, how are your kids? Are you spending time with them? And there were times I'd have to say, ouch, because I hadn't had time to be with them. In his obituary, it says that Ron was an avid sportsman and he loved the outdoors. From an early age, Ron loved spending time with the boys, hunting and fishing, and the exploits of the boy or men are tales worth telling. Ron loved to go to Colorado elk hunting, and as long as the animal was moving, he was a great shot. It seems that when big game animals were standing still, he couldn't hit the broad side of the barn. And Brad tells the story of a time they saw a doe off in the distance. They both jumped out of the truck, and before Ron got on the scope, Brad had fired a round to make the doe run. Ron quickly dropped the doe, and he turned to Brad and said, "What in the world did you do that for?" And Brad said, "Because you've missed everything that was standing still today, and I thought I'd give you a chance with him running." He was good at that. Ron really was, though, a great shot. And he never wanted anyone to challenge his prowess. On one occasion, while hunting pheasants with a large group of family and friends, a man by the name of Russ beat Ron to the shot and chided him that he was getting slow. Now, if you knew Ron very well, those were fighting words. And for the rest of the morning, every bird that got up, no matter where it was, in front of the large group going through the field, Ron shot it. Nobody had a chance to fire a round. His brothers went to Russ at lunchtime and said, "You'd better go apologize so we have a chance to hunt today." And once he said he was sorry, everything got better and a few others got a shot. I love the story, Brad, that you shared of going up in a great snowstorm with Dad's truck and the trailer and another truck and burying yourself in 3 foot of snow and pulling one truck out and getting the other truck stuck and getting to the place where you'd said, "We've had enough for today." And about 9 o'clock at night, they decided it's too late to set up camp. We'll sleep in the horse trailer. So they pushed the horses out and blanketed them and they set up in the horse trailer and they all laid down and they fired up a little propane heater. Ron never liked the cold. So he kept shuffling and moving till he got right up next to the heater, which was not the best because he caught his sleeping bag on fire. They got that taken care of, and they all got a night's sleep. And in the morning, when Brad went to open the door, the men said, "Don't open that door. It's cold out there." And they opened the door, and how warm was it? Like 40 degrees, blue sky. Perfect day to hunt. Darren learned a valuable lesson about hunting in cold weather from his dad. He had something to do with the Gatorade bottle, kind of like this. You can ask him to fill in the story. I'm not going there. As Ron's eyesight began to fade, shooting became just a little bit more difficult. A trip out to do sporting clays with the boys one day kind of proved that there were some needs that had to be addressed. Ron stepped up to shoot on the part of the range where they were shooting at quail, and the quail shots are a little different on sporting clays. The clays are about half the size, and they go really fast, and they shoot out doubles every time. And so Ron steps up to shoot, and he says, "Pull," and nothing happens. He doesn't fire. They set up again, and he says, "Pull," and nothing happens. He doesn't fire. He turns around, and he looks at the young man who was pushing the button, and he says, "Young man, this is how this works. When I say pull, you push the button." Darren told his dad, "Dad, he did. And the clays have gone out both times." So they moved him up just a little bit in the lane, and he never missed another shot. Ron's last hunt for hogs was for hogs this past January. And as usual, he got his and the hunt was over. It was just something special he shared with his boys. Ron also enjoyed boating with his family. He and Kathy loved to boat and to camp, and they raised the boys on great family vacations and trips to the lake and other places. I love the story they shared of going to Houston on vacation. It was a great time at the beach. They were just absolutely loving it, but they noticed that the beach kind of vacated, and they thought, "You know, this is kind of cool. We got the beach to ourselves." And so they enjoyed it that day, and they enjoyed it the next. Nobody on the beach. It was just wonderful, swimming and playing and enjoying the sun. And then somebody came out and said, "Are y'all aware that there's a hurricane coming?" And so they packed up and left, and that was the hurricane that pretty well destroyed Galveston, Texas. It was a big storm. But they stayed it out and enjoyed every moment of it. Trips to the lake were incredibly fun. They had a little yellow banana speedboat that had just a little 460 cubic inch motor in it. It was one of those things that flew across the water at like 95 miles an hour, and it was kind of fun. It had a little bit of a pole to one side, so the story is that if you were racing someone, you either had to be on the side it was going to pull to or make sure you beat them, because there was going to be a wreck if you didn't. They loved getting behind that boat. It could pull up 14 skiers at one time. It had power. They enjoyed doing all kinds of exploits, and they would do pyramid skiing across the lake, and the whole lake would just stop and watch and see all of the things they did. Ron was behind the boat one fateful day, skiing and enjoying life, unaware of the fact that Darren had waxed the skis. They were sliding through the water just really well, a wee bit faster and better than normal. And when it was time for the end of the skiing trip, the boat headed to the beach and cut a sharp corner, and Ron went flying up towards the beach a little faster than normal. He didn't quite get off in time, and he wound up sliding straight up the beach through a campground, past a campfire, before he came to a fateful stop. There was a man at a picnic table who looked at him and said, "Are you okay?" And he says, "Yep." But he spent the rest of the weekend in the trailer. For Ron and Kathy, the family and camping and traveling were an incredible part of their life. Few people can say they visited all 48 states in a truck and a camper, and then they went to Alaska on a boat and Hawaii on a plane to say they'd been to all 50, and they enjoyed every single moment of it. Ron Boyer was a special man. About a month before he died, Ron asked Kathy to call me and have me come over. And as we sat there that day, knowing that things were not going to get better, Ron looked at me and he said, "How can I be sure that I'm ready to meet the Lord?" I smiled and I looked at him and I said, "Well, Ron, there's a couple verses of scripture I want to share with you." And we looked at Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 that say, "If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God has raised you from the dead, you'll be saved." And I said, "Ron, have you confessed with your mouth Jesus is Lord? Have you asked him to forgive you of your sins?" There were a few tears. And he gripped Kathy's hand pretty hard and he said, "Yes, I have done that." "Do you believe Jesus is your Savior?" And he says, "Yes, he is." And I looked him in the eye and I said, "There's no need for assurance, Ron. You're ready to meet the Lord." And he was. There wasn't a Sunday that went by when Ron and Kathy were here in the church that he didn't seek me out. A pastor's friend, he would come and he would shake my hand and often give me a hug and tell me he loved me and told me how thankful he was that I was his pastor. He taught the little girls, as he called them, to do the same thing. And since they were just little bitty things, they have come running on Sundays when they see me, and they have given me hugs. And my heart has been warmed. They've grown up now. When they come running now, they usually jump. It's not as easy as it used to be to catch them. But girls don't stop. Because every time you do it, you bring your grandpa back to me. Ron Boyer was a special man. He was a man of principle and integrity. He embraced the truth and expected those around him to do the same. My prayer is that each one of us who knew him will follow his example and will live our lives to put God first and with that be honest, upright, and above all truthful. Because those things, along with his family, were the only things that really mattered. May God add his blessing as we celebrate and remember his life. Kathy asked me that I would share one of their favorite hymns today. And so as Debbie and I share the great hymn, How Great Thou Art, consider with me the wonder of God, the God that Ron served, and through these verses, allow him to speak to your heart.
Oh, Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds swing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, and when I think that God his son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
I looked into Kathy's eyes last night and I asked her, is there any particular passage that just became very special to you and Ron? She looked at me and she said, you know, The last few months, Psalm 23 became very, very special. And I shared with her that I would share some remarks from that psalm today that speak to what God provides us. He says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You've anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Those words this morning, there are some incredible promises and truths that I just believe the Lord can use to help us today. They helped Ron. They gave him courage to keep a stiff upper lip and fight as long as he fought. And if you knew Ron Boyer, he fought a long time. He fought hard. He wasn't willing to give up. And I think it's in part because he knew the words of this psalm, but more importantly, knew the God who ministered to him through them. In these words, I see these special truths. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And in those words, there is the promise that you will always be cared for. Shepherds watch their sheep. When there's a need, they come alongside and they care for them. They never leave them alone. They watch for them always, and they do everything that needs to be done to care for them. And so it is in the way that God cares for us. David goes on and he says, "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul." And in those words, there is the promise that you will always have what you need. God doesn't promise to bless us with more than we need. He just promises to bless us with what we need. And down through the years, Ron and Kathy knew that their needs would be provided, and they were. Faithfulness to the Lord meant God would be faithful to them. And there was always enough, because that promise is true. David went on and said, "He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake." And in those words, there was this promise that God would always lead us down the right paths in life if we chose to follow. Ron had an incredible sense of commitment to right and wrong. He understood the differences between good and evil. He was a man who expected truth. He taught his boys, "Don't you ever tell a lie." And the amazing thing about that commitment of his is it wasn't a commitment that just came because that was who Ron was. It was because he'd made a choice, especially in his latter years, to follow the Lord. He embraced the truth of Scripture, and he embraced the God who was represented in it. And the choices that he made and the pathway that he walked was one that was led of the Lord. David goes on and he says, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort and protect me." In those words, there is the promise that you need not be afraid, for God will always be with you, even in the toughest parts of the journey. Had you had the opportunity, which most didn't because of this crazy COVID virus, to have gone by the house in Ron's latter months, you would have seen a man who was kind of wasting away. He just was getting smaller and smaller, but he was also getting tougher and tougher. He just fought. He wasn't afraid. He didn't allow the thoughts of what death would be like and what it would bring and all of the things that he'd have to go through to get there to bother him. He just kept fighting. That's not innate to any of us. That's a gift from God's hand. For when he promises to walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death, there is in that promise the reality that he'll be with us when the darkness comes. And he'll hold our hand and he'll provide for our needs and he'll carry us through. And he doesn't do that only for those who are dying, but he does that for those who are living as well. And as a family, you found the grace of God faithful to carry you through. I remember the stories, Darren of the night spent with Dad. Special times. Caring for his needs, getting up with him when he had to get up, just helping him when he got confused. But there wasn't fear in any of that. There was strength. There was the assurance that God would bring you through. David goes on and says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." And in those words, there is the promise that God will bring peace and unity in our hearts, in all of our relationships. 64 years of marriage yesterday. 64 years of marriage. Kathy would probably love to say there was never a fight. There was never an argument. There was never a disagreement. But in those times when she wanted to kill Ron or Ron wanted to kill her, they found grace sufficient to work through the problems. Now she said a time or two, Ron had to say, "Well, I'm going to have to think about it." But most of the time there was just this sweet presence of peace that God melted and molded their hearts together, exhibited by 64 years of marriage. And I've repeated that a lot because I want it to be an example, a lasting example of what Ron helped teach all of us, that you keep your word, that you honor your covenant, that you stand strong, and you love well. David went on and said, "You've anointed my head with oil and my cup overflows." And in those words, there is the promise of blessing and abundance as you walk with the Lord faithfully. Ron and Kathy enjoyed three boys. One of them left far too soon. But in the life that they shared with their children and now grandchildren and now great-grandchildren, they found the blessings of God overwhelming. Ron would talk to me about the wonder of spending time with the kids, the grandkids. He'd go out of his way to be with them. There was a Sunday, it's been a little while back, when we looked down the street and here came a car with flashing lights behind it. Ron pulled over. He'd been caught. With two little girls in the back seat, I'm quite sure that he was wondering how he was going to explain this. Well, the reality is he hadn't put his new sticker on his license plate, and he took a lot of grief that day. But you know, he spent that day with children, grandchildren, and was blessed to have them with him. And he said to me that day, "You know, even in that, there's a lesson that we can all learn." David said, "Your goodness and loving kindness will follow me all of the days of my life." And in those words, there is the promise that when Jesus is Lord, your life is filled with goodness and grace. And even when the times are tough, he promises to be with you and to provide for your every need. Things got hard over the last year. There were a lot of tough days. But the one thing, Kathy, that you and Ron enjoyed was the presence of God who saw you through. On the bad days, you learned just to take it easy. On the good days, you learned to celebrate with joy. You knew the goodness and the loving kindness of God. And in those moments, Brad and Darren, that you and the kids and your spouses got to spend with your dad, it was special. Because you knew the grace of God was present. The final truth that David shares is the one that's most important. He says, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And in those words, there is the promise that if we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, there is the assurance that we will spend an eternity with him. This morning, Kathy, we don't have to wonder where Ron is. Scripture declares that if you confess and believe, you'll be saved. And out that night, a little over a month ago, when Ron breathed his last, he became absent from the body and present with the Lord. And he will spend all of eternity there with the Father, in a place prepared especially for him. I don't know if there'll be a yellow banana boat there. I don't know if there'll be a big truck and a camper there. I don't know if there'll be a bull elk to shoot. But I do know this. God will be with him. And he'll be waiting and he'll be watching for each of you. This morning, each one of those promises are ours. If we open our hearts and invite Jesus Christ into them. Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone would open the door, hear my voice and open the door, I would come in and dine with him and him with me." My prayer is that we would accept that invitation. And like Ron, we would say, in the end, this is what matters most. I just want to know I'm ready. And I'll be with Jesus. Ron picked a song for today. And we're going to hear that now.
Gathered round your grave to grieve, wish I could see the angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. You work on earth is done.
This morning, I want to thank each one of you for coming. Your presence is and has been a blessing to Kathy and the family, and on their behalf, I want to thank each of you for being here. Out of concern for the COVID-19 virus, we're going to dismiss each one of you shortly, separate from the family. The family is going to remain seated here in the sanctuary, and once everyone else has left, they'll leave as well. While they would love to greet you, they just had a strong feeling that they wanted to protect all of us instead. And so they've requested that you just make phone calls, give Kathy a call and love on her, send cards, and that will be a great way to express your care. And we hope you all understand. Please pray with us. Father, we thank you for this moment and this day. A day, God, when we can celebrate the fact that one of your children is now home with you in heaven forever. And while we await that day, God, when we too will be reunited and we will join him there, we just ask that you would be with us, that you would strengthen us, that you would equip us, that you would help us to find the grace that we need for every day. Bless Kathy and Brad and Darren and all of the family today. Envelop them in your love and in your care. Wrap your arms around them and help them today, Lord, to know your peace that passes understanding. And now, for as much as the spirit of Ronald Charles Boyer has returned to the hands of the God who made him, we therefore tenderly commit him to the care of our Lord Jesus Christ in sure trust and certain hope of the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall give to us new bodies like unto his. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you for attending today and for being a part of this service with us. God bless you. And you are dismissed.